In this diagram, we'll examine the process of folliculogenesis. Folliculogenesis is the development of the cells associated with the female gamete cell, the egg or oocyte. It occurs in its entirety, folliculogenesis, within the ovary. The culmination of that process is the release of an ovulated egg, shown here. It's taken up into the uterine tube and delivered via ciliary action along that tube where fertilization can take place. If fertilization does take place, implantation can occur over here in the uterus and a pregnancy can develop. Now, development of the follicles begins in the embryonic phase in females, and it begins with the production of the gamete cells, the oocytes, and the association of cells with those cells. They're known as pregranulosa cells. So we have this darker layer of pregranulosa cells around the yellow oocyte or egg. There are about 5 to 7 million of them developed pre-birth, but they undergo dramatic atresia. This is a programmed cell death that results in dropping that number of primordial follicles down to about 2 million. At birth, we continue the process of atresia and reduce that number further to less than 500,000 by puberty. And so here we have puberty being indicated. At that point, we develop intra-ovarian signaling that begins this folliculogenesis cycle. It takes nearly a year to develop from primordial follicle all the way to the end to this mature follicle over here that will ovulate the egg. And there are multiple cohorts developing at any given time. Ovulation occurs about once every 28 days, yet this cycle is taking nearly a year. And so we must have multiple cohorts that are offset in time in development occurring at the same moment, right? So we've got these multiple cohorts being developed. So a given cohort is being stimulated to go from a primary to a secondary follicle. The granulosa cells divide and we form multiple layers. We're actually going to pull in cells from the ovarian cortex. They're going to become associated with this follicle. These are the theca cells. They're going to work with the granulosa cells to help support that developing egg, the oocyte. We undergo some further atresia. We end up with more developed secondary follicles. These are called antral secondary follicles. They actually have a fluid-filled space. As you can see, the egg is beginning to become isolated within this fluid-filled space. And we end up with, in the end here, recruitable antral secondary follicles. These are the follicles that enter an ovarian or a menstrual cycle. Ovarian cycle being specific to the actions in the ovary, menstrual cycle including coordination with the uterus. Now, there are a dozen or more of these recruitable antral follicles, yet we want to ovulate a single egg, and so it's very important that atresia occurs during this menstrual cycle, during this ovarian cycle. And that's going to be aided by the anterior pituitary hormones that are going to help for selection of this one Graafian or mature follicle to ovulate its egg. And we're in this sort of initial follicular phase of the ovarian cycle where we're reducing down to a single follicle. You can note that our egg is now isolated in that fluid-filled antrum. It's got a surrounding layer of cells known as the corona radiata. That's actually essential to fertilization if it's going to occur. And once again, hormonally controlled, we're going to get ovulation of that egg with its surrounding corona radiata. It's picked up by the uterine tube and delivered to sperm if sexual intercourse has occurred. Now, what we're not seeing here is the second phase of this cycle, the luteal phase, because it's not part of the follicular development. And that's when we essentially are waiting to see if fertilization has occurred. If it doesn't, then this cycle will reinitiate and we'll get the second batch of recruitable antral follicles and we'll drive them through this process again, generating ovulation about once every 28 days.